Hi, I'm Jenny Brockie. Tonight on Insight, love bait, online romance scams.
Australians losing at least $8 million a month.
Did you fall in love with him?
I even melt now looking at that photo.
He always signed his messages as hopeless romantic Gary.
How much money did you send?
Approximately $380,000.
This program will save thousands of people across this country.
Welcome, everybody. Good to have you with us tonight. Jenny, you lost a six-figure sum in just 6 weeks in an online romance scam. How did it start?
I went onto an online dating website. I was contacted by someone who seemed legitimate. Took the romance, if you like to call it that, offline, and that's where it started.
So a photo popped up. Who did this person say he was?
He said he was living in Perth. He was working in the mining industry, originally from the United States.
Okay, and you were living in Perth as well?
Yes. The suburb, he said, was probably 20 minutes away from where I lived.
And what did you think when you saw him?
Seemed attractive, professional, yeah, legitimate, clean cut.
How quickly did it become romantic?
For him, a week. Yep.
And how romantic in a week?
He said his name was Gary. He always signed his messages from the first message as hopeless romantic Gary, which I thought was just a bit of fun, really, but now I realised it's all part of the game, yeah. Mm.
And what sort of things would he say to you?
The first email he sent was extremely lengthy and gave details of himself, that he was widowed, had no children, no siblings, no parents, was all alone in the world. Different qualities about himself, like his religious following and what he believed in and things like that.
Mm. How long before you fell in love with him?
I don't think. He convinced me I was, but it's not really a falling in love. It's a more like doing as you're told.
What do you mean?
It was quite controlling. And ironically, I was not comfortable with a lot of things he used to say.
What sort of things?
After a little while, it'd be things like when I come, because he always professed he was coming. Oh, that's right. He did profess to have to leave Perth and go to the UK and finish a contract. And it was always that he was coming back. When he came back, we would never be apart again. And so on and so forth, which made me very uncomfortable because I didn't like the possessiveness of it.
So he was avoiding meeting you all the time?
It was the finish line was always moving. It was always a week and then another week and another week. It was always moving.
That's interesting. So you'd been in a 25-year marriage and you were going through a divorce, and he just gradually became more and more controlling with you?
Yeah, and every time he wanted money, or the communication would intensify in frequency and just what it was, and it would be relentless.
When did he start wanting money?
Probably after about 2.5 weeks.
How much?
$10,000 initially.
$10,000? Mm. And you gave that to him?
I actually gave him more than that.
Why did you do that, do you think?
I really like to know that myself. I thought I was helping him.
Had you spoken to the person you thought...
Yes, I received a phone number from him while he was allegedly still in Perth, and it looked like a Perth phone number. I now realise it was not. It was dialing to a computer somewhere.
What was the money he asked for?
For the project he was working on, for various consumables and wages and things like that.
And why was he saying he couldn't pay that money?
First of all, his money had been delayed, and then because of the delay, the project had gone a bit south, so he needed money to make up for the fact that things had gone wrong because he hadn't had the money in the first place.
How many tranches of money did you send altogether?
Four. One was teeny tiny, and then three very large ones.
And you don't want to say how much altogether, but it's six figures.
Yes.
Well into six figures?
Yes.
Okay. Tracy, you thought you'd met this man, who you thought was an American-Australian soldier, through a dating website called Are You Interested?
Correct.
Now, after about 5 weeks, he told you he'd found gold in Afghanistan.
Yes. He said that he'd found 125 kilos of gold bullion. and he had hidden it. He'd stolen it from the Taliban, and he had hidden it, and he was putting it in a bank vault in Kabul and needed money to pay the fees on the gold.
And you were sending him money how soon?
Initially it was only very small amounts. Just the original bank vault fees were, I think, $700, $800. And then it progressively got higher and higher and higher, and then it got to $10,000, $20,000, $25,000, till it reached close to $80,000.
Altogether, you sent $80,000 to
them. Yeah.
Or to the people you thought were here.
The man I fell in love with, this fictitious photo here.
How quickly did you fall in love?
Very quickly.
And why do you think you fell in love? What was it like? Explain it to me.
I've been looking after my mum for six years, caring for her. My children are adults. I led a very lonely life, gave up my job to care for my mum, worked part-time, had no social life whatsoever, no friends, because I was a full-time carer and primarily worked from home. And I've been single for 8 or 9 years. And
how did he seduce you? Or how were you seduced on that site?
To me, I just look at him and I melt. I even melt now looking at that photo. And he said the same thing about me. It was almost like a instant attraction straight away.
So even though you know it's a scam and that he's not the person you were communicating with, you still connect with that photo?
I do, yes. I actually know the real soldier now and his wife. And they both know that I still look at him, this particular photo, and have emotional feelings for this man.
You know who that really is now?
Oh, yes.
But it's not the person you were sending money to?
No, the person I was sending money to was a 22-year-old Nigerian kid who I found as well. I know where he lives, I know where he works, I know everything about him.
The scammer was talking to you on the phone, mm-hmm. and also talking to your mother?
Yes.
Yeah?
And my children.
And your children. Mm-hmm. So what was the scammer saying? And were you getting suspicious?
No, not at all. I come from a military family, so there was an element of doubt there regarding some of the things that he was saying. Both my parents were military. Especially when he was sort of saying things like, we're running out of food, we need money for food, can you send an extra $500? Mum and I both sort of went, you know, the army doesn't work like that. We've been in the army, we know what it's like. That's when suspicion started creeping in.
Did you ever Skype this person? Or?
We did Skype once, but his camera didn't work, which is the same usual story you get from all scammers.
So you were getting the voice, but you weren't getting that.
Yeah, and he had an American accent. He had the twang.
And he quickly took your relationship off the dating website as well, didn't he? Facebook page.
He got me off Are You Interested very, very quickly. And then onto Facebook, and he asked me to set up a private Facebook profile. I never used Facebook before that. And it was just him and I with our own private Facebook profiles.
And you were in love.
He sent me an engagement ring.
He sent you an engagement ring.
I still wear it on this hand to remind me of the deception, the lies, the deceit, and my fight for justice.
Is the engagement ring a fake?
Yes.
A fake stone?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Did you find that out at the time or you found out later?
I found out later.
Okay. Bill, you joined a dating site called Gay Romeo after your wife died. Your wife of 30 years, yeah?
Yes.
Died. Why did you join the site?
When my wife passed away and my two children were grown, I found that society had changed and accepted those who were gay into society far more than what they used to when I was a young person. I've seen that was my opportunity to live what rest of my life I had the way that I was intended. And it was only a short time that my posting had been done that I got this reply, which came from a US Army sergeant in the Middle East. And I was a lonely person then, and I was looking for a new life. And what transpired between us made that promise of being possible.
Mm. Did you fall in love with him?
I developed a love of him, but a respect and a willingness of find out more.
So how long did this go on before he started asking you for money?
He didn't ask me for money. He asked me if I would accept delivery of a box, or two boxes.
So boxes with money and gold in
them? He dispatched the boxes from Baghdad with a consignment note assigned to a courier, a diplomat courier, and those boxes went to Heathrow in England. And it was when they reached Heathrow that there was a request for certain documents that had not been supplied.
How much money have you spent of your own trying to get those boxes?
The boxes themselves would have probably been $50,000.
And there's other money on top of that?
The boxes themselves were placed in a security firm which requested payments from me for their demurrage, and it went before the Supreme Court of Ghana.
So how much money altogether would you have spent?
I'd have gone up to about $80,000 altogether.
When was the last time you sent money?
Oh, about 8-9 months.
And you sent it to Ghana?
Yep.
And you've since been told by somebody that the soldier, the person in that photo, who you understand to be Miller Duncan, you've been told, a man called Miller Duncan, you've been told that person has died, is that right?
I was provided with a death certificate.
Do you believe that?
I did, but I'm sceptic of it now. And I was also supplied with a set of his fingerprints.
When did the police get in touch with you, Bill?
Well, that would be probably over 12 months.
And what was that like? What did they say to you?
They came knocking at my door and asked had I been sending money by Western Union, and did I know where it was going and such. And through their conversation, we agreed that that's what was happening. It was a scam, which I quite was prepared to believe.
And what was that like when you heard that?
Well, it's just a case of not having much to begin with, but what you did have has gone. I lived a debt-free life at the beginning, and from what I did there, I took out a $50,000 mortgage on the home that I owned, and that was all used.
And what about Miller Duncan? What about the man you thought you knew in that photo? Do you believe the person you'd been communicating with was the person in the photo?
I did, yes, because of the number of separate photographs and what was sent to me.
And you still believe that?
I think so.
Detective Superintendent Brian Hay, you have led the way in fighting against some of these online romance scams, and you've spent a lot of time working with Bill.
Yes.
What do you think's happened here?
When you talk to people that have gone through this shocking experience, there's still elements that they believed because it becomes an intrinsic part of their life. It became the purpose why Bill went into debt. It became the purpose of why he went without food for days on end. It became the purpose for why he sold his car. And he changed his complete way of life because the only thing he had was his future, his hope, and he wanted love.
Bill, do you know what's happened to your money?
It's probably given somebody a good time. That's about where it's gone, I'd say.
Tracy, do you know what's happened to your money?
I certainly do. It bought him a really nice brand new home and a car while I'm in the process of losing mine, an enormous amount of gold jewellery. And he has blatantly plastered that all over Facebook. And I'm not the only victim. There's 14 of us now that I've found. So, yeah, he's having a very good life.
Brian, how much money is involved in these scams, just in Queensland where you are?
Queenslanders send about $1.6 million every month. We're one-fifth the average nationally. So, look, an Australian's losing at least $8 million a month. But that's an insight to the problem because...
People are really shocked by that figure here. I mean, there's people with their mouths wide open.
Yeah. Our research shows that for every dollar that goes to Nigeria, there's another $1.04 going to one of 41 different countries. So all of
Where do most of the scammers come from?
Nigeria is certainly the hub. We've seen a great movement towards Ghana over the past 10 years. I've been to Ghana, spoken, work with their officials. They estimate 70% of their offenders in their country are Nigerian. We've seen a lot of money go to Malaysia over the past 3 years. Again, that tends to be a Nigerian population. We've had Nigerian fraudsters in this country. We arrested one Nigerian woman who was targeting people in the United States.
Who do you think is most likely to be vulnerable to these sort of scams?
Look, we are all vulnerable. No one is excluded from that statement. If you are approached with the right story at the right time in your life, you may very well fall victim to a scam.
Why do you say that with such confidence?
Because I've spoken to so many victims, intelligent, articulate people that have led immaculate lives, made good judgments, good decisions, and all of a sudden you think, well, how could they make a decision? Why could they not see the obvious? But their vulnerability at that point in their life means they wanted hope. We go out and buy... How many of us go and buy a lotto ticket for a big jackpot coming up? Because we live in hope.
And when people are in love, they do crazy things.
But they're also extremely convincing too. With their documentation, everything that they present to you is extremely convincing. Very convincing.
So we've got some pictures of some of the documents that I think are floating around. Here that people can have a look at. And Bill, you said that too, didn't you? That the documents convinced you.
I have stacks of documents at home that are so convincing. And
we have a propensity to believe what we read. And when you go face to face every day, we build up a sixth sense or a degree of body language signals that we say, yay, I nay, I wouldn't trust, I would trust, I'll lend you the keys to my car. There's something about, I don't know what it is, but something about this bloke I wouldn't trust.
Jenny, you were smiling when Brian was talking about these people are intelligent, sensible, you know, got their life together kind of people. Were you connecting with that
Absolutely.
Picture of yourself?
Yeah. Yep, definitely. And also with what he just said about the sixth sense, and there was often times where something would be said, like, you know, the possessiveness, or even down to the fact that, oh, you know, he'd lost his wife, and I always thought, well, I'd like to ask him that. It's not appropriate to ask someone that online, so I'll wait till we meet.
One of the things, Jenny, that makes it so difficult is the scammers, fraudsters, scumbags are skilled at isolating the victim from their support networks.
Yes.
So they become the person which you emotionally attach and you depend upon. They have nothing left. They have no money. They have no future. They have no hope. They don't have a support network and friends and families. And that's why we find a lot of people attempt suicide, consider suicide, and it's an ugly word, but it's reality.
Here you are as Mark Hannish, Michael Hannish, Hannett Blankson, Glenn Hannish, Hannett Glenn, another Mark Hannish, a Hannett Mark, and finally Hannett Scott. Why? Tonight we're talking about online romance fraud. Lieutenant Colonel Gordon Hannett, thank you very much for joining us. You're at a US Army base in Kuwait. Now, your photo is known to hundreds and possibly thousands of women around the world. Why?
Well, they've been used in internet dating scams since about 2009.
Do you know how many times it's been used?
Oh, good Lord. Thousands, I'm sure.
All right, we did a quick search of your photo, your image, and we found 10 Facebook profiles, just very quickly, using your photos. We'll just run through them. Here you are as Mark Hannish, Michael Hannish from Virginia, Hannett Blankson from California, Glenn Hannish, another Glenn Hannish from Afghanistan. Then we have a Hannett Glenn, another Mark Hannish, a Hannett Mark, again Mark Hannish, and finally Hannett Scott in Syria. What's that like for you?
Well, it's been irritating and frustrating. I get on Facebook almost every day and I check for scammers and I report them to Facebook. They don't always delete these scamming accounts. Sometimes they'll say the person has not violated Facebook standards and they'll let them continue on with their fake profile.
Do you know why it started with you? I mean, why were you chosen for this?
Well, another interesting thing about this is I joined Facebook in 2009, so I didn't find out about this until I got an email the second day that I was on Facebook. A woman wrote to me and basically cursed me out and called me an evil person and a scammer, and I had no idea what she was talking about. And after that, I started receiving more and more of these messages from women on Facebook. At this point, I've heard from more than 550 women on Facebook through messages telling me that I've been involved, my pictures have been involved in scams. I keep track of them, too. I have a notebook with all this information. But almost every day, I hear from some new person about how they've been scammed by someone using my pictures.
And do you have any sense of why your pictures are so appealing to fraudsters?
Yeah. I'm not a particularly handsome guy, but I think... But the reason is that in every picture when I was in Iraq back in 05 and 06, I smiled. And mostly because that was my first deployment to overseas. And my mom was a little concerned about me going to Iraq. And so I made sure that in every picture I smiled. And so it looked like I was having a good time, even though I wasn't having a good time.
Okay. And what sort of requests are they making for money? And what reasons are they giving for wanting money when they do it, when they pose as you?
I've been in the Army for 29 years now, and it baffles me that people fall for some of the things they come up with. One of the most common is the leave scam, where they'll tell the woman that, hey, I want to come visit you, or I want to come marry you even, and the only way I can do it is to go on leave, and the Army makes me pay a fee of $400 or $1,000 or $5,000, and I don't have the money, I don't have access to my bank account, can you pay that fee for me? Now, anybody who's ever been in the military or knows anyone in the military would know that there is no such thing as a leave fee. A soldier simply turns in a form to a supervisor and he goes on leave. It's easy. But these women fall for it, and men too. There are lots of female pictures that are used by scammers as well.
Tracy, did you have doubts that this person really was who they said they were?
No. No doubt whatsoever. I believed everything that he said. Up until the gold. When he was courting me, I believed everything that he said.
Were you telling anyone about it?
The only person that I had to talk to was my mum and my children. My children basically didn't want to know anything about it because I actually borrowed money off one of my daughters to send to him. My mother, I spoke to her about it. My mum's quite old and quite ill. But then she was in the military and she actually said to me, sounds a bit sus to me, Trace, you know, like I don't think, you know, that a US Marine would be going without food. But in saying that, a lot of the money had already gone, or most of it had already gone. So,
John, tell us about the woman that you thought you'd met on the seniors dating agency website.
Very attractive lady from lived in Seaforth in Melbourne. She was born in Australia, went with the parents over to the States.
We've got a picture here of this person, who this person was supposed to be.
Had lived in the States all her life. Her uncle had a gem business or a jewellery business in Australia. He'd passed away. He had no children. His wife had passed away earlier. She was apparently his favourite grand or niece, and he willed her the business. She came to Australia to take over the business. It also had an agency running in Kuala Lumpur, which required attention because they considered that the person running the business there was stealing from them. And it was her aim to go over there and to close the business down and sell the stock off and then come back to Australia.
Now, you'd been single for about a year
when
you met who you thought this was.
That's right. It was a lot of people involved in it. And as I've talked with the fraud squad in WA, it's very extensive, it's very well planned, very well executed.
So it started with a request for $900 for
That's
a
right.
flight to Australia. And then that was delayed, and then there was insurance for the gems
That's
that
right.
was needed. And what reasons were you being given all the time that you were being asked for these tranches of money?
Majority of the reasons were that the Customs and Taxation Department and the Commerce Department were putting these unpaid fees and everything onto the stock that was required to be bought out. The original thing was that they had to be valued, and she had certification and valuation certificates for it, for all the stock. And the lawyer that was handling it for her was helping with the interpretation of the language and everything for her, prepared all the paperwork and everything.
Were you talking to this person?
I spoke to the lawyer, yes.
Did you speak to her?
I spoke occasionally.
Or spoke to who you thought she was.
Who she thought she was. Communication was always very hard. Most of our communication was through type Skype because she said in Malaysia that's the most efficient way to get through. The telephones sometimes work, they don't work. Which sort of, at the time, I thought was a bit strange that,
were you
I was very careful to be.
As the request for money started coming in, were you suspicious?
It became a very much an urgency thing that, we've got this one more hurdle, we get this through, I'll be on the plane, I'll be back in Australia.
So you were caught up in a process, really.
It was really a snowball
what
process.
What you thought was a process. Yeah. Jenny, you talked about doubts. So how were you feeling when you were making the payments? Did you feel confident about what you were doing?
Absolutely not. And the last one I made, I was feeling physically ill. I was absolutely just shaking. I still did it though. I can't explain why.
Had you told anybody what you were doing? No. So it was totally secret. You were doing it.
Yeah, it's the isolation, definitely. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm.
What about you, Bill? How were you feeling when you were making all these payments?
Anxious. Telling myself that I was a fool. A fool, what I was doing.
You were saying that to yourself,
yeah.
were you?
I was sending money away that I didn't have. That I was sending money away of which I should have been using to pay the debts that I had accumulated. Mm.
John, you eventually, after all of this, carry on with this situation and increasing demands for money and so on, you eventually got an hysterical call from this woman who called herself Victoria and her solicitor, supposedly at Kuala Lumpur Airport. What did she say?
She was supposedly made the last payment. The gems had been cleared. She was walking through customs and as she was walking through, an Australian woman asked her if she'd assist her with a package. And when she'd gone through customs found that this supposedly had drugs in it, and she was arrested for transporting of drugs.
And did she ask you for money at that point?
She was supposedly arrested by the customs, and her solicitor person came into the customs and negotiated with them, and for $90,000 they would let her go free.
So you were asked for the $90,000.
That's right.
Did you pay it?
No. I paid some of it, but I was just
totally... You paid some of it. How much?
I paid $20,000. And I was just... That was my total end. I couldn't do any more.
And you also got a call from somebody claiming to be her sister in America, also hysterical about what was going on.
Her daughter... Her only sister was going to die, that unless I could do something about it, that she would die surely, and I had to do something, otherwise I'd have blood on my hands.
So you were being put under incredible pressure.
Yeah,
emotional pressure.
The other call I finally had was from the supposed gem buyer.
So this was an incredibly elaborate.
It was elaborate
operation.
When I rang the gem buyer in America, the phone number came up as a San Francisco number. Her sister's number came up as a Baltimore number. So they had the phone systems and everything all worked so that it was so obvious.
So every time you tried to check something, it checked out, or it seemed to check out.
I even tried to do. There's a security site on the computer in America for checking out people, their identities and everything. And I went through and put all the details in and paid the $30, and that was a scam.
Yeah.
But that was.
How much money did you send to this woman called Victoria altogether?
Approximately $380,000.
Over what sort of period of time?
Over about 6 months.
And when did you realise you'd been scammed?
I didn't like to think of it, but the last time when she went through the customs, I just shook my head and I thought, no, this can't possibly... These incidents couldn't possibly happen to one person. And that was why... I think had I had the same endeavour I'd had in previous occasions to raise the money, if my heart was in it, I would have still raised that money to get her out. But then I started to realise it wasn't true.
How did you feel when that dawned on you?
I had a very sick feeling. I've worked so hard for so long, and you just see it sort of within 2 seconds pass before your eyes.
Did you have the money to give, or did you borrow money?
I borrowed about half of it.
And where did you borrow it from?
From friends. I've got some amazing supportive friends.
Did you tell them the story?
Yeah.
And they believed it too?
The most comment I got was, if you believe it, we believe it. See, sometimes friends are amazing things. They can do you good and they can do you bad. I wish they had have said no.
Dom, you know, this case, it falls under your jurisdiction. Yeah. What do you know about the scammer? Do you know very much?
We're learning more, and we've struck up a relationship with the Economic Financial Crimes Commission in Nigeria and other law enforcement around the place. What we found in this particular case, there's a certain bank account the money's gone into. There's also other people's money going to that same bank account as well. But within law enforcement, as Brian knows too, we hit a lot of barriers too, and have already been alluded to. We don't always enjoy the same cooperation that we do within Australia when you start talking about overseas bank accounts and things.
What do you want to elaborate on that?
For the certain countries, obviously, that just fob us off as well. For whatever reasons, whether it's because of their own internal corruption issues or whatever else.
How do you approach people you think are victims? What do you do?
Within our Project Sunbird structure, we're able to identify where funds are going overseas, and the initial approach made by us is a form of a letter. It's a letter that goes to the household where the money's come from, saying that if the money's going to these particular countries, and we're talking about Ghana, Nigeria, Sierra Leone, Benin and Togo, they're the countries we're most focused on. If money's going off those places, it's highly likely you're being defrauded. If the money's still going overseas, we back that up with a second letter.
OK, how often do you have to back it up with the second letter?
We find we're stopping about 60% of the people we're engaging with that first letter.
And when do you get involved face-to-face?
We try and prioritise. We're looking at people where we're getting information they're about to travel. We'll try and stop them from travelling. We had a very unfortunate incident very tragic incident with a woman that did travel to South Africa and was found deceased. And we're also looking for people that are sending in the vicinity and over and above $10,000. That's how we have to try and prioritise. And then it's the home visits.
And how do people react?
Most people don't believe. It's when you get those little bits, little snippets through a simple thing like a Google image search or something along those lines.
Brian, you actually intercept people at the airport. How do they react if you try and stop them?
Yeah, not a great deal of success.
So for you, it's really important to get the message out about this tonight.
Look, I guarantee you this program will save thousands of people across this country. If you look at the sheer volume of Australians going into dating websites, if you are on a dating website, you will be approached by a fraudster. There's no... If, maybe, but it will happen.
OK. Ken, I'm interested in just asking you about this because you're a private investigator. You don't like these cases, do you? You don't like doing them. Why?
Because they're frustrating cases to work on because very difficult to get results, very difficult to recover money, and also very difficult to convince the actual victims that they are a victim in the first place. There's never a happy ending. That's the problem. There's never really a happy ending to these sort of cases.
What about the role of dating websites in all of this?
You can use a fake name, a fake photo, a fake birth date, and away you go.
Tonight we're talking about online romance fraud. Brian, what about the systems enabling all of this? Because we've heard mention tonight of a whole lot of ways that people are meeting and making contact and so on. I'm interested in the money. How is it so easy for these vast sums of money to end up in the hands of international criminals?
Look, we have a very efficient cash remittance process. If I want to send money to a fraudster or a fraudster wants me to send money, it would take 2 minutes. I go into a cash remittance agency and I simply fill out a form and I send it and the money's gone. It can be picked up by the crook a couple of minutes later anywhere else in the world. We see a lot of money being transmitted through banks, electronic transfers, and that's where we see some of the big sums. It won't be a $10,000 transfer. It could be $250,000 transfers.
Well, I know most of the cases here, not yours, Jenny, but I think all the others went through Western Union. Is that right?
Western Union's the largest in the world. They've got more outlets than anywhere else, and I dare say that's one of the reasons that they're so used.
And what do you think of the way that they do business and the role they play?
I think the cash remittance agency can stand up a bit more. We've been to Western Union. I've been to MoneyGram. Western Union put their hands up to come forward and actually do some education processes with us. A couple of years ago, they launched the SAFE program. Is that enough? Am I, poor old copper from Queensland allowed to have an opinion? I'd suggest, no, it's not personally.
What would you like them to be doing?
Well, I think not just Western Union, but the whole banking finance industry needs to get up and say, hang on a sec, we've got a responsibility under anti-money laundering legislation to know our customer.
OK, Lynn Walker's here from Western Union. You do emphasise speed with the transfers. I mean, you sell your business on the basis that you can collect money transferred internationally within minutes. Are you making it too easy for this to happen?
It's a good question, Jenny. I mean, essentially, our business is built around being able to service a customer base where people have families back home that are relying on money. And they're the majority of our customer base are people who are genuine customers that are living in this country, working in this country, and are trying to send money back to their families. So the question is, do we deliberately slow everything down for the sake of what might be a fraud transaction to the detriment of all those genuine customers?
Look, I'd say on the high-risk countries such as Benin, Togo, Nigeria, Ghana, there could. Well, why not put a 48-hour time delay on it to give a cooling-off period and recommend that client go get some base? Because I can show the stats, and the majority of the money that goes to those countries is fraud.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Well, hasn't Western Union just made it easier to transfer money to Nigeria?
I did see that information come through. That there are going to be some new services available in Nigeria.
Yeah. What do you think about the idea of in some countries slowing it down and doing a bit of an investigation?
We do have a lot of controls in Western Union now. We have education both before a customer sends a transaction. We have education during the transaction, and we also have back office controls. So. Essentially, when you go to Western Union, you can't send a transfer without seeing a little quiz that we have on the forms that say, do you know who you're sending to? Is this supposedly to pay for a lottery win? And a series of little questions. We also train our staff to ask questions, and obviously we give them a lot of guidance around suspicious transactions. And then at the back end, we have transaction monitoring. So the troublesome jurisdictions are the ones that obviously we're looking at in terms of volumes and things like that.
OK. I know, Jenny, you tried to transfer money through Western Union and you had to go somewhere else because they wouldn't let you. Is that right?
That's right. Mm.
So you went ahead anyway, even though you had a warning from them.
Guess who I called? Hopeless Romantic Gary.
Hopeless Romantic Gary, exactly. To get advice on how to do it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I've got to say that it's true. A lot of customers push back very strongly when we try and deliver that message. We can't put in so many roadblocks that our genuine customers are being impacted by that.
Mm. I just think that we need more of a duty of care over the individual by all banks and Western Union, MoneyGram.
But the individual has to be alert
to this
stuff too.
But I know I sent most of my money through a reputable bank. Not once was I asked, do you know where the money's going?
So you felt like it was too easy?
Very easy. Very easy.
What about the role of dating websites in all of this? What do people think about? We've talked a little bit about that. What do you think about that, Jenny? You went on RSVP initially.
I've been on a few, but RSVP mostly, yeah. That's where
That's
contacted
where you met Hopelessly Romantic Gary.
Yes, Hopelessly Romantic Gary. He might be, for all we know. I just sort of feel, from what I've learnt since then, that it is very, very easy to create a profile that is completely fictitious, mm-hmm. with a stolen photo. There is no requirement to prove who you are or supply ID. And I think that's something probably missing, because everywhere else in Australia, in financial institutions, whatever we do, you know, to put your mail on hold or redirect your mail, you have to have ID. And there's this one thing where there's this a huge gap, mm-hmm. where you can use a fake name, a fake photo, a fake birth date, and away you go. At no stage is there any requirement.
We have tried to contact all the dating agencies that were involved in these stories that you've heard tonight. RSVP wouldn't come on tonight, but theirs and other responses will be on our website for anybody who'd like to have a look at what some of the agencies have to say. Now, Dave, you did come on. You're CEO of Oasis.com, which is a free online dating website. How often do you find fraudsters on your site?
Look, we take this matter extremely seriously. We want to provide the best user experience. In terms of finding fraudsters, look, we have a four-pronged attack to this, which is we have invested very heavily, and by heavily I mean millions of dollars, in technology that we've customised to actually try and block out as many not getting there in the first place. We then actually pick up what we think is the rest within about 2 or 3 minutes.
How do you find them?
Look, there's a number of ways. IP address is one of them. There's certain behavioural traits that we can look for. There's certain, email addresses and particular traits that they do. What we need to do is try and educate people, which is great. We're having shows like this, and that's why we're not afraid to come on this show. We provide a lot of information on our site, and one of the major points here is if someone asks you to jump off our site, that should ring alarm bells with you, because all of a sudden they're trying to get off something that is going to eventually capture them.
So, do you do automatic Google image searches of everybody to make sure they are who they say they are?
Our customer care staff have a direct link into Google Images when we're manually approving everything. So everything gets manually approved before it gets published.
They have a direct link, but do they use it
on every photo? Not on every photo, no.
Okay. Brian, what are the chances of fraud survivors seeing the perpetrator ever go to court or any kind of justice?
I'll tell you now, it's slim. But we have between Ghana and Nigeria and Malaysia, over 30 arrests through stings we've set up so far. A couple last year working with the Economic and Organised Crime Office in Ghana, a couple of perpetrators on bills matter. Our first one in Nigeria got 19 years imprisonment.
But it's not common for people to get their money back or to see someone go to court.
I'll always tell them you'll never see your money again, because I don't want to give false hope. You know, these people have lived enough false hope. It'd be wrong for me to put them in that position that they think there's a glimmer. Get on with, you know.
Jenny, you're one of the very unusual ones. You have got some of your money back very recently. How much?
As of a phone call today, 40% of what I sent.
Wow. You got a phone call today? Mm-hmm. And there's been an arrest in your case just this month?
So I've been told, yes.
Yeah. Dom, what do you know about what's happening here?
Yeah, at the moment in Nigeria, they have apprehended someone. Jenny, through her own endeavours, as I was saying before, it's not because of anything we've done as a police agency to get the money back. She's taken on her own endeavours to achieve that result.
OK, we are going to have to wrap up. I know, Delia, the ACCC is making this a priority, isn't it? Why?
Because we've been seeing the complaints and the money lost grow year by year. 2009, it was 600 complaints, 6 million. Last year, it was 25 million and over 2,000 people contacting us. And we've been doing a lot of education, but clearly education alone isn't enough. We're really impressed by the disruption work that's been going on in WA and in Queensland, and we think we need to do more to help notify consumers elsewhere in Australia that they may be a victim of scams, and also more work working with the enablers, be they the dating websites, the money remitters, the Facebooks, the email services that allow it to happen.
Could those enablers, as you call them, be doing a lot more?
Some stuff's been done, but yes, I think clearly it could be more could be done, and I know Brian and others have also been working on this. So we want to look generally at that to see what sort of systemic solutions we can put in place to try and cut down on the opportunities for these scammers.
Okay, Jenny, you say you can pick a fake profile a mile off now. What should people look for?
Well, if it's a lady looking for a gentleman between 50 and 60, he'll probably say he has no children for a start. He'll be widowed, possibly separated, divorced, but there's no baggage to speak of. If he's saying he's in Australia, he won't be from Australia. He'll usually be someone in the mining, or certainly in my area, he'll be in mining or something like that. And you can really start, if you read enough of them, you'll pick the language. It's poor English, or the profile will be very much about what I would like to do for a woman, not like a typical Aussie bloke, I like barbecues and water skiing sort of thing. So...
Is that what
we're saying? A lot. I think...
Beware poetry.
If you read it, and also in the selection criteria, they'll be happy with a woman that fits every category there is. Look for the, no punctuation, no, the grammar's poor, things like that. And if anyone's communicating with someone whose music tastes are U2, Uncle Cracker and Norah Jones, stop now.
Yeah. That combination. There are many reasons I could... Anyway, we won't go there. Brian, what should raise alarm bells for people?
Oh, they're overseas. You know, keep your love domestic. I know that in Jenny's case there that this person claimed to be from Perth, but you know what? There couldn't be contact there. So never send money overseas. Check your images that you receive from this person. Do a Google image search. Do a TinEye image search. If you can dig in the internet, you'll find ways to check and identify the IP address. Yep. And all of a sudden they claim to be in the UK, but the IP's bouncing back from Lagos, Nigeria. You know you've got a problem. Yep. You've actually got to take a little pill called cynicism, take it a couple of times a day, and question anything on the internet.
I just want to ask each of you, John, what do you think now when you look at this period of your life, this slice of your life?
I think I went from a teenager to a very old man very quickly. I no longer have the same, and I take the point of taking a cynicism tablet, but I've always been very open with people, very caring and sharing and wanting to help someone that's seemingly in trouble. Now I'll always ask 3 or 4 questions more than what I normally would. But in reverse to the whole situation, that I, through the dating site, actually met a very nice person who I've now been in a relationship now for 6 months, and we're sharing a good time together. And she is a real person. Which is returns a little bit of faith into human nature.
Yeah. Tracy, what about you? If you'd been warned when you were in love, would you have listened to anyone when you were in love with this photo?
Yes, I'd never even heard of a dating scam. I led a fairly sheltered life as far as the internet was concerned. I never ever used it. Now, my life, as far as I'm concerned, I don't trust anybody. I have barriers all the way around me. I don't believe that I will ever be able to chip away at that wall ever again in my life. It's really destroyed my life.
Bill, what about you? How do you feel when you look at this slice of your life?
I wait until I wake up of a morning and find out whether I have to live that day or not. And I find out what I do during that day. I hope that I'll wake up tomorrow morning. But I have very little left and very little time to accumulate anything again. So I've dished myself out what I have, and I have to make do with that.
Incredibly brave of you to come on tonight, all of you. I mean, really extraordinarily brave and really worthwhile, I think, for a lot of people watching to hear these stories. So thank you so much. Jenny, I just want to finish with you. How do you feel looking back at this period of your life?
Yeah. If someone had told me in the middle of October that I'd be sitting here now for this reason, I would have said rubbish.
This was just October last year.
Yeah. Well, in December I found out. But I guess it's just what happened. But I was very fortunate to have three amazing children and some great friends. And my daughter actually said, Mum, don't let this define you, because this is not what you are. And don't let it define the way other people see you. And that gave me a lot.
Mm. That's a good message to end on, I think. And thank you very much, too, for sharing your story. Great of all of you to be here. And that is all we have time for here. As I said, you can go to our website to get some responses from some of the organisations mentioned tonight. But do let's keep talking on Twitter and Facebook about this as well. I really am interested in what you have to say about what you've heard tonight. We'll be back at the same time next week. Thank you, everybody. Good night.